Olayla biz 2 yıl önce de 2 kurs beraber yapmıştık. Gerçekten çok renkli bir kişilik, tanımanızı isterim. İsteroskopiye gönül vermiş bir cerrah. Çok seviyor ve çok değişik bir sunum tarzı var, birazdan izleyeceksiniz. Çok severek yapıyor. Dünkü konuşmamızda da söyledi, uterus. Aslında biz jinekologlar için çok önemli bir organ. Ve biz uterusla ilgilenmeliyiz. Bizim için elimizde böyle teknoloji varsa her şeyi yapabilmeliyiz diyor. Kendisini hayranlıkla izlemeye davet ediyorum.
Günaydın. Very lovely good morning to everybody. I hope that my translation in Turkish language is correct. I spent all my night on Google Translator trying to find the words about what I say. I asked Omar to help me, but I hesitated actually, because I had a very bad experience in Ukraine. My friend Omar of Ukraine, I told him, how can I finish my presentation? Give me some words like goodbye, thank you very much. He said, I give you a very nice word in Ukraine language. So I put it, I don't understand what it is. So with the last slide, when this word came over the girl, oh my God. It was, I want to kiss every woman in the world. So I don't trust anybody anymore. Well, it's always fantastic to be in your country. It's not about the dolma and the baklava, no, it's about the history. It's a great nation. So when I walk in the streets in Istanbul, I feel the history in my blood. I could see the Ottoman sultans walking next to me. I can feel everything. Every year, look at the colors. Look at the colors. When you have your breakfast in London or in Paris, you don't have these colors. It's only bread, omelette, okay, finished. But these vibrant colors only here. Everything is delicious. But the most fantastic in this country is the people. Insani? Okay. This is really the most fantastic. So I want to say tashakkur ederim for each and everyone coming to my lecture today, but special thanks to the people who helped me to come, to the Tom Cruise of endoscopy, right? A lovely man, right? Give him an applause, please. Let him feel happier. He drove the car from Bursa to here, maybe 2 hours, 3 hours, just to be with us, to welcome you, to talk about his society, to tell you that he wants to serve you, to teach you, to bring something new. And also I want to say thank you for this lovely lady, Uznum. We are friends from long time. We met in the Zakaita hospital with my other beloved Uznum, all right? And she said, Osama, I want to invite you again to Ankara. I thought it's just a compliment, but she did her promise and I'm here back again. So I'm happy to come. Thank you, Uznum, for bringing me here. And I met my friend, Dr. Bulan from Istanbul, Arjun. So many friends I see among the audience. So I decided, as a compliment from my side, to dedicate my textbook about mastering the techniques of hysteroscopy to Dr. Uznum and to be in your hospital here. So this is for you, Dr. Bulan. Well, another surprise for you. Maybe a few people know that I have Turkish blood. That's my grandfather, right? Typical Turkish man, okay. Typical Turkish man. Till he died, he cannot speak Arabic well, all right. And he came to Egypt. He was a friend of Kemal Atatürk. So Kemal Atatürk sent him to Egypt. Egypt was a very rich country at that time, to start political relationship. So he came with his Turkish wife, and he fell in love with another Egyptian lady. Typical Turkish man. So he married my grandmother, and the Egyptian wife was very strong. The Turkish one was very kind-hearted. So the Egyptian one, she said, don't go back to Istanbul, stay here. So he spent all his life in Egypt. And this is actually his certificate from Istanbul University. He graduated from Istanbul University. Okay. Proud to be a gynecologist. I'm sure that everybody chose this specialty, think that this is the best. So, over the past 50 years, there was a development and improvement in the medical services and in the equipment we use in our operating room and in the office. So let's compare other specialties versus gynecologists. Let's see how much we developed in comparison to other specialties. This is how the ENT specialist used to examine in the office, all right? To look into the body cavities, ear, nose, and throat. They use this metal combs, same like your speculum, okay? But not anymore. All ENT specialists now in the office are using the scope to look inside the ear, the nose, and the throat. They are not anymore using these metal things. They are using very high advanced optics and mini scopes to look inside the body cavities. What about urologists? Urology is very much like us. They have a hollow organ connected by two tubes to a solid organ, okay? So, urologists, they never do D&C for bladder polyp. Never, okay? They don't have an ultrasound machine in their office. We are weak. We gynecologists, we are weak. We borrow technology from the radiologists to use it in our office. You are not a radiologist. You're a gynecologist. They use the scope. And something very amazing. The urologists, when they do cystoscopy, they never call themselves, I am a cystoscopist. So why you call yourself, I am a hysteroscopist? You should not say this. If you're a gynecologist, hysteroscopy is routine. Hysteroscopy is performed in the United Kingdom by the nurses. Nurses are doing office hysteroscopy. You see how much we are very far away. So, office gynecology developed. Let's see the development of office gynecology. This is in the 16th century, how they used to examine the body cavity of the vagina. What about today? 200 years ago, this lady, her name is Anne Bouvet. 200 years ago, she designed that speculum. So what is the situation today, Dr. Sardar? It's the same. Okay. You are using 200 years old speculum. That's very unfair. So the only development of gynecology was only in the examination chair. All right? But not in the equipment. Only the exam. So it's time for change. This click. It's time for change. Everything changed in life. This is the way of speculum examination. This is the old time. Today we have the iPod. Even Turkish women have changed. This is how they used to look in the past. But not anymore. They are different. So we have to change in our practice as well. Every cardiologist has a certain image. White coat, stethoscope. The same for gynecologists. You should have your hysteroscope. The hysteroscope is a personal equipment. It's not for the operating room, it's for your pocket. You put it with you. In the office, you use it to examine the vagina. I will show you how. But we have to agree that why everybody is talking laparoscopy, laparoscopy, laparoscopy. Why there is very few people doing hysteroscopy? Why? Despite the abdominal cavity is not your home. No, you are a gynecologist. You are trying to copy the surgeon. You are jealous from the surgeon. You want to do, but you are a gynecologist. Your home is the uterus. I'm really getting crazy. The surgeons are removing now technique, the gallbladder, transvaginal cholecystectomy. Have you heard about this? And the gynecologist removing the uterus transabdominal. Come on. The uterus is the only organ in the human body which already one third of it hanging outside. Right? So why want to jump and cauterize and injure the bladder and morcellate just to say, I'm a laparoscopic surgeon. So your home is the uterus. Everything should be from below. Hysterectomy, vagina. Endoscopy, hysteroscopy. So why hysteroscopy is not popular? The answer is, doctors are not happy with the view. Oh, you know that. All you get at hysteroscopy is the Japanese flag. All right? This is the view. Where is the sound, my friend? Where is the sound? Please don't touch the controls. Tell him. I control the sound from here. My presentation is cinematic, so don't. So what you get at the hysteroscopy with this Japanese flag, a red circle over the white background, right? Terrible view. I don't know what is this cutting here and what is doing here. So with this situation, you will not love to do hysteroscopy. You cannot see well. How you get a diagnosis like this? It should not be like this. It should be different. It should be like that. This is the way it should be. And this is the Times News writing an article. Cairo-based Dr. Shawki bats for hysteroscopy. Means he is fighting to push hysteroscopy. This is the way it should be. Insertion, very clear. You see the cavity, you see the pathology, and you see the polyp. This is the way it should be. And the septum should be like this. Very clear, so you can finish in 5 minutes. And then I did an interview, this is in the Italian TV, this is in the American TV, talking about what I love. Mawlana Jalaluddin Rumi said, you know Jalaluddin Rumi, the best pleasure in life to speak about something you love in front of people you love, okay? So I love hysteroscopy, and I love you. If you open YouTube, you'll find 3,600 videos you can download and learn the techniques. Seen by, how many people have seen the videos? 1,400,000, 1.5 million. So go to YouTube and see these videos. Why people cannot enjoy doing hysteroscopy? Now I'll tell you the secrets. This is the design of most of the available hysteroscopes in the market. This is the channel for the water, right? So this channel brings water to distend the cavity. What happened is, most of the design, they have the operative channel going through this flow channel. So once you put the scissors, what will happen to the flow of water? It will be very weak. not enough for distension. So the cavity will collapse, so you cannot see well. Another problem is, I designed my sheath, this is my design, which has separate channel for the instrument than the fluid channel. So it will not affect the flow of water. Another thing is the distension pump machine. We were using this machine yesterday. What happened? It was not enough. Pressure was very weak, and we had to use manual pressure. And the assistant in the operating room was holding the bottle of water like this and squeeze, just to give me pressure. So why you suffer? I designed my pump, it's called Schauke Histrojet. Histrojet. Yes. The other pump give you a pressure maximum 150. This can give you 400. Oh my God, fluid overload, patient will die. I am giving you 400 as a backup. If the pressure is not enough to distend the cavity, or if there is leakage from the cervix, you can increase the pressure. Same like I give you a Ferrari car with a big engine. If you are driving in the streets, you don't have to speed up. But if you are climbing the mountain, you push the pedal to get power to jump up. So this is a very important information which was not in the mind of people. You should have enough pressure to distend the cavity. Listen what I said, enough. I didn't say number, I didn't say 200 or 300, because it differs from one uterus to another uterus. The postmenopausal uterus is small in size, you don't need much pressure. So having a backup pressure pump is important to be able to complete intrauterine surgery, like big septum. Another point, I need this pressure of fluid to be able to examine vagina, cervix, uterus, proximal part of fallopian tube. So please share with me this new name. It is gynoscopy, right? In the office, you can examine the vagina. Actually, this instrument should go to the museum. I hate this instrument. Okay, the ENT specialist examined the ear. This is the organ of the ENT. For us, we examine the vagina. Tell me honestly, do you really see the vagina when you examine in the outpatient clinic? Do you see the vagina? This is the view when you put this speculum, all right? When you put the speculum, you look at the cervix. You have never really been able in the office to see the vagina. You agree with me? How many years you are working gynecologist and you have never examined the vagina? And then we teach the undergraduate, the young doctors, okay, manifestations of Trichomonas vaginalis, strawberry vagina. Have you ever seen the strawberry vagina? Never. Okay, so what I want you to do is to use it to examine the vagina. That's vaginoscopy. Look at the vagina wall. All around. Posterior fornix. Posterior vagina wall. So this should be the modern examination in the office. Look at the vaginoscopy view. So, hysteroscopy is not only for the uterus. No, it's also to examine the vagina. So in the office, you should have this scope instead of the speculum. Also, for the cervix. For the cervix, the view is different. Look at the lipsticks, like the rouge, okay? Of the cervix here. That's better than colposcopy. A beautiful view of the external os. Colposcopy can show you this view as well, but colposcopy cannot go inside to see the endocervix. This is another advantage of hysteroscopic examination in the office. Okay, this patient had severe dyspareunia, So she went to many doctors, nobody was able to examine her because of pain. So she went for a famous laparoscopic surgeon. He told her, okay, we have to do laparoscopy. He did laparoscopy, and then he came to tell, oh, you have spots of endometriosis, and we cauterized. But the pain, still there. Very severe pain. Look what I found by vaginoscopy. That's the cervix. And look at this. What is this? Deep endometriosis. Okay. Stuck in the vagina. And chocolate blood counts. Yesterday, we had the same case, a similar case in the demonstration. So, but some people say, oh, this is very rare. We don't see spots of endometriosis in the vagina because you don't examine the vagina. When you put the casco speculum, you don't see well. Infection. All manifestations of infection here. This is the strawberry vagina of Trichomonas vaginalis, okay? Look at the infection here. And also, you have the manifestations of fungus monilial infection. I'm sure that you are now convinced we have to change. Examination in the office should be different. Another very important point. Can you put the light a little bit, please? Hello? Stay with me. Lights on. Sometimes I want light on, lights off. We are the only specialty in medicine doing blind procedure. I'll wake up, okay. We are the only specialty doing blind procedure. Have you ever heard, no, I will put it like, a urologist doing curettage of a bladder polyp? No. And most literature agree that in the hand of best gynecologist, when you do curettage, you only touch less than 40% of the uterine wall, right? And if there is an endometrial polyp and you do blind curettage like this, the chance to get the polyp is only 30%. But some people, no. When I do curettage, I get the tissues of the polyp. Yes, you just do fragmentation of the polyp. You take some little tissues, but the base of the polyp is still attached. So please, DNC should now finish. It is DNC, see with your eyes, okay? No more blind procedure. DNC, in my opinion, is a deliberate crime. From now on, any pathology, any biopsy should be under vision. Some people say, but can we do hysteroscopy in the office without anesthesia, even in very narrow cervix, postmenopausal, lights off, please.
We should go ahead.
Okay. I will show you that sometimes, even if the, okay, this is enough. Even if the cervix is very narrow, like this case, this is pinhole cervix, postmenopausal, and there is some fibrosis here, all right? This patient, actually, she was VIP. She is the wife of the prime minister in my country, all right? And she had an endometrial polyp by ultrasound. She went to the top doctor in my country. He decided to do DNC. He tried to dilate the cervix, he couldn't. He failed, perforated. So he said, this is difficult mission, mission impossible. Do you know the movie? You know the movie, okay. And who is the hero of Mission Impossible? We will see now. Let's see Mission Impossible, difficult cervix, but not with Tom Cruise. All right. And even not with this man, okay. Okay, we need another, yes. So, this is external os. I will show you how, under vision, you can go into very difficult cervix. Everybody, look at the internal os. It is pinhole internal os. Very difficult to go. So what to do? Under vision, you can dilate this pinhole internal os. So you go and dilate. there is no difficult service. Whatever narrow it is, you can under vision dilate, create a very nice door, internal or window to go through. Now internal loss became wider, so it can go by the scope. And the pathology was these two endometrial polyps. So there is a lot of advantages of using office cystoscopy. Okay. What I want to tell you, don't be hesitant to use office is thrust without anesthesia. The diameter of the lens is 2.9 lens. With the sheath, 3.4, okay? The copper intrauterine device inserter is 4 millimeters, all right? Insertion of a copper device is more painful than office is thrust. Why? Because with copper device, you have to put a speculum. You have to catch the cervix by a tenaculum, and then you insert the copper device 4 mm. But with the office cystoscopy, the diameter is less. Just use the power of water to go through the cervix. Infertility is another big problem. I see so many of my colleagues here are doing infertility IVF. We succeeded very well in induction of ovulation and in fertilization, but unfortunately, the pregnancy rate is still not very high. And the patient become very crazy. Sir, you said that you put 2 embryos here. Why am I not pregnant? Because you don't check the cavity of the uterus. Look at this study. What are the hysteroscopic findings in the uterine cavity in patients with repeated IVF failure? This was published in Fertility and Sterility for 520 cases of failed IVF. When hysteroscopy was done, revealed 45% abnormal uterine cavity findings. So it is very unfair to let the patient pay all that money and then you tell her, sorry, there was a small polyp inside or arc with uterus or some problem inside. So when hysteroscopic correction was done and repeat IVF again, pregnancy rate improved to 50%. Despite it was 20% before hysteroscopic correction. So this will show the value. I'm very happy that Dr. Sardar and his lovely wife told me that we do routine hysteroscopy in IVF cases now. You will lose nothing. Just clean the cavity, dilate the cervix, and something more you can do, scratch. Scratch the endometrium, improve implantation. The same like the farmer, before he put the seeds, he scratched the soil, all right? So this improves fertilization and implantation, sorry. Polyps like this, very common inside the uterine cavity. You like this video, okay? That's the base of the polyp. This procedure can be done in the operating room or simply in the office. Under vision, you can see the base of the polyp. Why there is no bleeding? Because of the pressure of the water. The pressure of water should be higher than the arterial pressure. You cannot operate with a pressure less than 150. Otherwise, everything will look red. Very obvious, you can see the base of the polyp. The polyp is located near the ostea, near the cornea. In my opinion, it is more valuable to teach gynecologists about this procedure more than laparoscopic hysterectomy. Okay. Laparoscopic hysterectomy, you can do it abdominal or vaginal. But this only you need to do it by your hand. There is no other method. D&C cannot remove this polyp. Now we can see the pellicle and another small polyp here. And the big one is there. very strange shepherd. Why you are laughing? Congenital uterine anomalies, they are more common than what you expect. Look at this publication. The prevalence of congenital uterine anomalies in general population and high risk. High risk means infertility or recurrent abortion. In general population, the incidence is about 5%, but in patients with infertility, can be up to 8%, with patients of recurrent abortion, almost 25%. One quarter of patients of recurrent abortion, they have congenital uterine anomaly. This is the recent classification of congenital uterine anomalies. They put the letter U. U0 means normal. U1, the shape of the uterus is abnormal. They call it dysmorphic uterus, whether the T-shape or the small infantile uterus. The U2 is the septum, whether short or long, all right? When you have this picture, please tell me, what's your diagnosis for this histogram? Septum or biconium?
Septum.
Very intelligent man. This is classic septum. When the angle between the two corneas is less than 90 degrees, this is septum. You don't need to do any other investigation. But what about this one? Any suggestion? As he said, he made like this. Okay. It could be broad septum, it could be biconium. So you have to add another investigation. This is the other investigation, right? 4D ultrasound. This image is very important for me, especially because I had a discussion with Tom Cruise, Dr. Gorkan yesterday, about is septum fibrous tissue or muscular tissue? Please compare the echogenicity of the septal tissues with the lateral wall of the uterus. This is the muscles of the lateral wall, and this is the septum tissues, the same echogenicity. So septum is no more considered fibrous. It is very muscular. And if you inject water, you can make the septum more clear. This is another 3D image. This is one cornea, other cornea, and here is empty. So this is a bicornic uterus. So 4D ultrasound is the most important to differentiate between bicornuate and septum. Another big septum between two corneas, all right? And this is, so it is the 3D ultrasound is the most important for diagnosis. Earlier, we used to say long septum, short septum. There is no importance to differentiate. Sometimes the short septum makes more abortion than the long septum. So there is no any value to differentiate between long and short. That's another hysterosalpingography, and this is the 3D ultrasound. Please, Dr. Gorkan, look at the lateral wall here. Look at the echogenicity here. Compare it with the septal tissues. So the ultrasound shows that the echogenicity of the septum is nearly the same like the muscles of the uterus. And this is the view by hysteroscopy. You need a good distension to be able to stretch the septum like this. That's a classic diagnostic view for a septum. If you have this nice view, it will be very easy now by the scissor to chip, chip, chip, and you cut it by Macas, very easy. But you should attain this good view. This is the scissor and septum already finished. Yesterday, they brought me a case, septum, which was very easy septum, but the fluid pump was very weak, so the cavity was very much collapsed. If this is the cornea, other cornea, and you draw a line, the distance between the fundus and the lowermost part, if this is less than 1 centimeter, it is an arcuterus. By ultrasound, if this less than 1 centimeter, that's an arcuterus. If it is more than 1 centimeter, it is a septum. Okay? Should we treat arcuterus or no? She said no. All right? We used to say no. But look at this publication by Rudy Campo. He was the president of the European Society of Endoscopy. Say that no clinical reference of the height of the fundal indentation in subcutaneous or arcuate uterus, a prospective study. He came with the conclusion that arcuate uterus should be treated the same like the septum. And they did a study on patient of infertility for IVF with an arcuate uterus, randomized between correct the arcuate or don't correct. And then IVF was done. The pregnancy rate was higher in patient who corrected the arcuate uterus. So how to correct arcuate uterus? This is an arcuate uterus. You can do it in the office, no need for anesthesia. But you should have the proper equipment. That's the fundus. And this is the cupping of the arcuate uterus. Unless you have an intrauterine pressure more than 150, you'll not be able to operate. Because bleeding will happen and the cavity will be collapsed. Some friends will say, Osama, you said that the septum is muscle. Why it is looking white? The muscle looks white under the pressure of water. If you decrease the pressure, it will be very pinkish and bleed. So this is actually muscle. It is not fibrous tissue. And this is the final view. You see so many blood vessels. It is very muscular. Okay. So for a big and broad septum, you can do by scissors, but it's much faster and easier to use the resectoscope. So when you ask me when to choose MACAS or resectoscope, for the thin septum, even if long, MACAS is very easy. If it is a broad septum, broad, then you use the resectoscope. If it is vascular septum, also use the resectoscope. The technique that I designed and I advise, Dr. Sardar yesterday told me, Osama, I start from the top. Yes, you can do this. You can start from the top. But it's much easier to control from below. You move from here to there, like this. From there, like this. And you climb up until both tubal ostium is at the same line. The key secret of success. Number one, orientation. The cavity should be very much distended. Septum is stretched. And then you start cutting. So this view is very nice. Everybody look. This is the tubal ostium. And this is the septum stretched. So at that view, you can start exactly in the middle. This is anterior and posterior. Exactly in the middle. And make the tubal ostium is your landmark. This is my electrode. Not very high up or down. Make it exactly at the level of the internal os. And then start to cut. Everybody observe. When you cut into the septum, the tissue retracts. There is no residual tissues. This is our muscles. Look at this. Tissues retract. Dr. Sardar, look at the tubal ostium. This is your landmark. And you keep climbing up until you reach level of the tubal ostium. And this is the final view. Very beautiful view. Let us see how to do the procedure. Start. This is the start. Tubal ostium is here. This is a very broad septum. And move. Look at the retraction. Everybody observe the retraction of the tissue. Dr. Gurkhan, look at the muscle. These are muscle fibers. Look, these are muscle fibers. So, what can I do to convince you? Should I kneel on my knees and kiss your foot? The literature says muscle. The video shows muscle. You don't want to believe, okay. Go to Bursa and jump from the mountain, okay. So, this is the tubal ostium. Look at the vascularity. Don't say there is no vascularity, okay. Look at the blood vessels in the septum. It is very muscular. You cannot have this vascularity in fibrous tissue. These are muscles. I don't know what the singer is saying, but she's saying it is muscle, okay. So this is tubal ostium. And this is the real time of surgery. 10 minutes only. And this is the final part. Now I give you some more secrets. At the start of surgery, use very high pressure, 200, 300, and electrocautery very high. The more you climb up, decrease the pressure of water and decrease the electric water. Because sometimes perforation happens only by the pressure of water, right? So this is, look at the retraction. Look at the retraction. She said, septum is muscle. That's the final view. Okay. Little bit light, please. Little bit light. Light. After you have seen this video, do you need, this is before and after, right? Do you need a laparoscopy during septum surgery? Do you need a laparoscopy during septum surgery? He said no. This man lives inside the uterus seem like me. It's our home. Many people think that laparoscopy can prevent perforation. No. Laparoscopy will help you very well, help you to perforate. You know why?
Yeah.
He will keep waiting to see the transluration of light. Oh, come on. No. No problem. Oops. The light starts to appear, you are on the serosa. Okay? So it will not help. Look at the healing of the septum. I promised my friend Sardar, I will show you a video. This is my best. Second look after 1 month, and third look after 3 months, you will see how healing happened. Actually, healing, this is the scar of the septum of the same operation you have seen. Look at this island, Dr. Sardar. It is in the center. It's not coming from the side. So the healing starts in the center and also from the side. Enjoy this video. That's only 1 month. You can see tubal ostium here, and this is starting healing islands of the video. And then after 3 months, that's the view. Same patient. You will see no any trace or evidence of the scar, of white tissue. Everything is pinkish, complete healing. This is before and this is after. So actually, for septum cases, you don't need to put a balloon, no need to put lipase loop or to give estrogen progesterone. Healing is very quick after the surgery. But the most important, don't burn too much. Yesterday, Dr. Uzlum brought for me a very challenging case, complete Usherman. And the history was, she did septum surgery a couple of months ago or a year ago, so probably the cavity was burned, so Usherman happened. So you should be very clear in septum surgery, stretch the septum, have a panoramic view, cut exactly in the middle, and then it will heal very nice. Usherman syndrome is another problem where the uterine cavity is full of intrauterine adhesions. Let me show you a nice video of multiple intrauterine adhesions. These are multiple intrauterine adhesions. It is not a septum. These are adhesions. If you know how to use the equipment well, it will be like driving a bicycle. Actually, the operator in this case is not me. It is my son. He's 26 years old, just postgraduate. But he stood and watched how to move the scissor, how to use the pressure, and then I was standing next to him, right? This is the ostium. Adhesion was removed. There are more adhesions on the other side, here. Look at this. The tubal ostium and the cornea are hidden behind the adhesions. Now everybody look at this step. And you will appreciate the value of pressure wood. Look at the Sardar, look here. It is dissected by the pressure water. And then this is the nice view. Time of the operation is 4 minutes, 20 seconds. if you have a good intraepithelial view, you will finish very quickly. Because I love hysteroscopy, I want to invent new indications for hysteroscopy. So you have seen me showing you, examine the vagina, examine the cervix, uterine cavity is not enough. I want you to examine the fallopian tube to see the patency of the fallopian tube. Look at this test. We did it yesterday, showing tubal ostium and how to detect patency of the ostium by the bubbles. Look at this. A new method for assessment of tubal patency. You can see how the air bubble is flowing very nice from the tubal ostium. That's a very good test for infertility in the office. You do methylene blue test, Burkhan. You inject methylene blue, and then you see the spill from the ostium, from the fimbria. Let me show you a nice way. Look at this. One ostium here, and you see the bubbles go from this ostium now. Now, bubbles. But, look at this. Look at the methylene blue flowing from the tubal ostium. That's a beautiful bedside test. You can do it in the office. Look at this one. Because at laparoscopy, you cannot see the ostium. You see only the fimbria. And the ostium is more important than the fimbria. Again, you can use the bubble test or the methylene blue test for assessment of the both tubal ostium in infertile ladies. Very romantic test. Okay. Yesterday, many people asked me about the T-shaped uterus. The problem in T-shaped uterus is increased in the thickness in the lateral wall. So, how to diagnose T-shape? It is essentially by hysterography and by 3D ultrasound. How to reconstruct T-shape? There are no rules. It is the same like rhinoplasty. In rhinoplasty, I cannot tell you how much you will cut. You know the beautiful nose, okay, beautiful nose. So I will fashion a new cavity, same like the normal cavity, all right? At hysteroscopy, if this is the internal os, all right? Here is the internal os. When you are staying at the internal os and look, you will see the lateral wall sliding this way. This is the normal cavity. In T-shape, the lateral wall is going straight like this. You start cutting from here, and climb all the way up. But here, don't cut too much. Don't cut too deep. The more you climb up, cut more deep. So you fashion the lateral wall as sliding like this. How much you cut, I cannot tell you. You should try. One time you perforate and you will see the uterine artery, right? One time you do it better. Let me show you how to do it. This is a very classic, and in the T-shape, actually, Dr. Uslum, usually they have also cupping fundus, arcuate configuration. So let us see how to do the procedure. This is the lateral wall. Please observe, it's a very, very nice procedure to reconstruct. That's the lateral wall, okay? And this is the fundus. You see? You see the white color? This is not fibrous tissue. This is our muscles. The lateral wall muscles and the fundal muscles. So this is the T-shape. This is before and this is after. A complete reconstruction. 3D showing how the picture improved after. The last thing I'm talking about today, if I keep talking about hysteroscopy, I will not stop, right? There's so many things to tell. And so many things to tell about the technique. For example, yesterday I was telling them how to hold the camera. Everybody hold the camera like laparoscopy, like this. No, this is wrong. It should be like that. So your fingers have an access to the focus. Because in laparoscopy, when you move in and out, right and left, you don't need to change the focus frequently. But in hysteroscopy, only 1 centimeter movement, the focus is gone. So yesterday I was watching one case, and the focus was very bad. I thought it's the lens. But probably the surgeon has all the time changed the focus. You find hysteroscopers, the good hysteroscopers, is all the time doing like this. All the time changing the focus. So you have to hold that camera this way. One more thing, the control of the camera should be at your eyes. Because if the camera rotated in a 30 degree lens, the view would be very confusing. Where is left, where is right? You will not know. So you have to hold it like this so you can control everything. The classification of uterine fibroid, according to the European Society, three types. Type 0, with all the myoma bulging inside the cavity. Type 1, more than 50% inside the cavity and less into the myometrium. Type 2, most of the myoma deep into the myometrium. Definitely, this is more difficult than this, and this is more difficult than this. The size of the myoma, according to guidelines, should not be more than 3 centimeters. Why? The bigger the myoma, the less space around. You will not be able to move around. Let me show you this video about how big myoma can make the view bad. And one more thing, the bigger myoma will also make the possibility of fluid overload is higher. This is a big myoma. Okay? Look at this. It's filling the whole uterine cavity. And then I will show you the value of high pressure to be able to distend the cavity. You see, there is very little space to operate. I am trying to cut, but the space is very narrow. So now look what will happen when you increase the pressure of water, pressure of fluid. Okay. Now you created the space, so you have to start completing the resection now. Once you created the space, you can operate very safely. But let me show you applications in the office. In the office, for a very small myoma, you can do it without anesthesia, like this small myoma. This is a patient, classic patient of IVF, failed IVF twice, and there is a very small submucous myoma here. So you go by the scissors. This is the anterior wall. That's the small myoma. Just open a window. Cut the endometrium only. Only endometrium. Now you can see the myoma tissue. This is the myoma, right? Then what to do after? After you open this window, you go by the grasper, you catch and push inside, not pull out. Look, Dr. Sardar, this is the small myoma. Push, push more, and it is delivered from its bed and pop into the cavity. Look at this. Now, push more, push more. Oops, this is came out. Very little pain, not more than insertion of a copper device. So you take it out. This is about less than 1 centimeter myoma. This is the myoma bed. I'm very proud to show here the feeding vessel of the myoma. Look, this is the feeding vessel. If you want to see bleeding, I will show you bleeding now. This is the feeding vessel. And this is the bed of the myoma. And are you afraid of this? This is nothing. This is just a pinprick. It will stop spontaneous. No need for cauterization. Don't need to cauterize. Don't be afraid of that. All right? One slide. This is another submucous myoma. Cut deep into the base. And use the scissors to cut and to elevate the myoma. Look at this mechanism. This is cutting, more cutting, and then elevate like this. Look at this movement. Then the myoma is free. And you don't have to remove it outside. It will be expelled in 2 days. Because it's difficult to take it outside from the cervix. You have seen this. I'll go to another. This is a type 0 myoma. Just touch the base for hemostasis and then jump over the myoma and start resection. This is an easy type 0 myoma. You can see that this myoma has red degeneration. Look at the color of the myoma tissues. That red degeneration. You can use the electrocautery according to the tissue of the myoma. It's very hard. You have to use more high electrocautery current. And this is the base attachment. Or you can use the electrode lung dissection. I will show you how. Like this. Just push. And this is the base of the myoma. Finished. So procedure completed, and this is the lateral wall of the uterus, and this is the myometrium, the healthy myometrium. You have to identify difference between color of myometrium and myoma. This is to show how the color of the myometrium. This is the posterior wall myoma. I have only one case to show, one case more. You can see the color of the myoma tissues. If you don't have enough high pressure, bleeding will happen and you'll not be able to continue. You keep resecting till you see the pinkish myometrium. This is the myoma tissue. And this is the myometrium. This is the base of the myoma, right? This is the bed of the myoma, right? This is the pinkish myometrium here. This is the pinkish myometrium. This is the capsule of the myoma. The last case of the day, this is the last case before the goodbye. I did this case in Russia. It was at a workshop. In the workshop, sometimes they bring cases not indicated for hysteroscopy, right? They don't know what to do. So actually, this is an intramural subserous myoma. It's not submucous. It is not. There is no bulge into the cavity. And then the beautiful lady doctor said, "Okay, we trust you can do everything." I said, "Yes, but I'm not a magician, right?" Okay, so I said, "Let me try a new technique. I will go by the hysteroscope, by the scissor, and cut this fundus, so the myoma might fall down." So this was my idea. This is the fundus. This is the fundus. It looks like a septum. No, it is not a septum. It is a tennis ball myoma bulging into the fundus. So I started cutting. Look, Gurkan, this is white in the fundal myometrium. It looks white, right? And now you will see the myoma. This is the myoma, right? So expand the window to see the myoma more. I started to feel very happy, very optimistic. That's a new procedure, new operation that I desired. But unfortunately, the myoma didn't fall down. I looked to my side, very beautiful doctors, blonde, nice. "You will not be able to remove the myoma." I said, "Okay, I will try." So I decided to do Mission Impossible. That's a laparoscopy myoma screw, side by side to the hysteroscope. Side by side. There is no channel to go by this. This is a 5 millimeter myoma screw. and screw in the myoma and then pull down. So keep your eyes watching to see how the myoma is very nicely delivered from the intramural subserous to become submucous. Look at this. Myoma is coming more, and pull down. This is the myoma now, boom, coming more down. After that, I did the resection, and it was easy resection. This is the final view. This is the cavity. This is the tubal ostium. And look at this. This is the myoma bed. This is the myoma bed. Okay? But how to close this cavity? I cannot take sutures. But look what will happen when you decrease the pressure fluid. The edges will come to each other. Right? So this is the ostium. And this is the cavity of the myoma. I finished the surgery and I told them, okay, this is now will be good healing. So the doctor said, but this will be a very defective fundus. There is a big cavity in the fundus. How this will heal? Okay. I said, give it a chance and do second look. They invited me next year for the same congress and said, sir, we brought the patient to do second look. Oh my God. Everybody was watching the second look. So now let's see the second look after 1 year. Okay. Now going into the cavity and looking to the fundus. This is the fundus. Complete healing. You see, complete healing. Very little white color. And this lady had successful IVF pregnancy and she has 2 daughters. And then I enjoyed a very nice souvenir pictures with all the Russian doctors. These are the group for me, okay? So that was the finale. And life is full of beautiful things. Make people happy. Give people hope. Give them skills. Let us live with the concept, me and you, not either me or you, okay? The sky is very big to accommodate all stars. Humanity has to mature into more love and friendship. Love and friendship is the greatest power in the world, more strong than nuclear power. Great nations rise up by love and by friendship. So at the end, I want to say, tashakkur ederim. Thank you, everybody. I love you all. And thank you, Osman. Thank you, Burkan. And I wish you all the happiness in the world. Thank you.
Thank you for your excellent presentation.